be really like crazy presentation because I spent most of my time preparing, and it'll come up later in the presentation, but I spent most of my time preparing for the expo. But to start off, this is stuff I've been working on. My name's Cory Brown. I'm a student here at Marshall. I'm a junior, I think. I probably have more than 3 years under my belt, but at the same time, credit-wise, Marshall wants more money out of me than I want. I'm the president of AFO Studio. I just got my business registration. I'm able to hire people now. I can actually pay unemployment. that is, for a bunch of tax reasons, that's probably more exciting than it needs to be, but it's cool to me. I'm the current president of the Marshall University Game Developers Guild. I hope that all of you decide to vote somebody else in. Not that I'm tired of doing it or that I think it's not a great cause, but I just don't have a lot of time for it. And personally, my nomination goes to Tim. I was the assistant director of the first annual West Virginia Game Developers Expo. Also, I'm a freelance game designer, developer, and animator. So if you guys ever want to make a video game, get at me. Winky face. Got it. Go to the next slide. A little bit about me. I dropped out of high school after my sophomore year, so I technically do not have a high school diploma. I graduated Mount West with honors with an animation and game development degree. I got a job as an intern at Strictly Business Computer Systems, which apparently is kind of rare at this school, or at least within CIT majors, because computer science majors usually get that position. I was accepted at Marshall University, and now I'm just waiting for my financial aid to run out any minute. I wanted to talk about this just because I made this game in this room. It was a really cheesy, if I have to say, shitty game that I made inside of this room on these computers within a week. And it was just, I used the Android SDKs that were already installed on the computers. I used Unity. And it's pretty much just an endless runner, Flappy Bird type game with a little bit of physics. So you just have to jump over these blocks and it counts the number of times you've tapped on the top of the screen. It's a pretty simple concept, but 7 people reviewed it so far and it's 4 out of 4 stars, pretty much because all those people know me. It got me used to the Google Play Store. It got me to know like what size this banner is, what size this icon needs to be. It's the first game I ever had that had an ESRB rating, which was interesting going through that. Surprisingly, you will drop an entire ESRB rating if you have any kind of Nazi content inside your game. It's interesting, but at the same time, hopefully expected.
Nazi
No, I didn't want to. Like I even put the photos.
You know what? You know, like a passing Nazi joke.
Yeah, I mean, it is what it is. I put this is actually I kind of faux created. If you notice, once this thing goes away, I faux created this alternate logo for my company just as like I didn't want it to seem like I started off where I am now. So I created a first logo that was not my original logo, and that's the logo that's on here, and it started off as One for All Studio, and now it's AFO, which is All for One, so it went from One for All to All for One.
My Hero Academia?
Yeah.
So, like, you live long enough as the hero to see yourself become the villain here?
Exactly. It's almost like Google created Microsoft to destroy itself. But I wanted to talk about this just because this is the first time that I've made a game and actually got paid for it. I work at Strictly Business Computer Systems, and we made a game. I got paid hourly as an intern there, and we made this drag-and-drop game for an iPad that is now at Heritage Farm. You can go to Heritage Farm and play it right now. But pretty much you would go, and it's to teach kids about the Simple Six machines. So you would click on, this is just a PowerPoint, obviously, but you would click on the windmill, whatever that is, and it would open up, and you would drag and drop whatever you thought was a wheel, and whatever you thought was, I forget what they are even now, lever, wedge, wheel and axis, incline plane, blah, blah, blah. You would click on all those, and you would drag them, and you would sort them. It was an educational game. The goal was to hopefully apply for different grants and get Heritage Farm some more notoriety. That game is currently on display. There's another game that we've been working on for Heritage Farm. I don't know if that one has been made public yet, so I don't know how much I'm allowed to talk about that one yet. But this was a game that we made for, this was our final for, I guess now would be 340, but it was 360, and it was the Unity class that Matt Mundell teaches. It's Hobo Hot Box Soccer. And, I mean, it is what it is. It's essentially, what we wanted to try to kind of make, it was a prototype of a game some other students were working on. I worked on it with Cameron Asbury and
James
Keeling, last name? I think it's Keeling is his last name. James Keeling, we worked on this game. It had a different plot to it, but we kind of refined it down to, like, what are we going to get finished by finals? And it was, we took the main character, Barry, which is over here, so I'm the J. There's a particle system actually on this somewhere where it's actually during the main menu. There's smoke rising up from it. But it was just a soccer game. You could pick up PCP, which is what this is, and it would make it would make whoever picked it up two times bigger. There's cocaine, and if and if the player picked that up, they would be two times faster. And if a player came over and hit the J, it would almost enter into a bullet time mechanic, where you would pretty much move slower. The other player would move slower, but you would still have access to real game time. I just took a random screenshot. It's actually co-op in a way. Not co-op, but I guess not even split screen. Couch co-op, I guess. Where one person would be using WASD, and the other person would be using the arrow keys, and it's actually meant for like two people to play against each other with one keyboard. It was real simple. It was our final. We got a decent grade on it, so it's okay. This is another game I worked on. I'm currently working with my friend in South Carolina to try to build up his game development company. It's Columbia Gaming Studio, and this was a game that he wanted to make that was kind of like Asteroids. These little pink guys are the enemy that I made. It's just a test enemy. These are power-ups. Obviously, this Gore shoot, it's made for Android phones. I tried to put most of these in chronological order. This also was my project for 240. I was experimenting with UI sliders. I didn't really get a good shot of.
I remember that.
This is what I presented at the end. I didn't present it. I had it at a booth at the expo last year. This was the game that people played.
I thought it was cute.
Alright, I made this at Mount West as a test for an open world. I was just getting used to Unity. I wanted to figure out their like atmospheric environments. And I made this as a screensaver that would be animated. A lot of people came up and said, I can't believe this actually looks like a video game. I thought that students around here just played video games. And I remember that being so insulting to me. And just being like, so, I mean, we're spending all this money to go to school for game development, and you think we just sit around and play games. It's like a slap in the face. So this was the start of me being like, you know, something has to be done or else we're just going to be a joke, pretty much. So I started making this little capsule human. Started making it by scratch. It had controls, pretty simple controls of holding an AK. It eventually evolved into this, which was, it's almost like a third-person survival, like Gears of War / zombie / who knows what. I'm still making it. It's kind of a test game. That turned into this, which I downloaded and I have to play for you guys. Really, the only thing I was going to show you out of it, though, was the particle system. It is. No, it's just a zombie. She can be a hooker if you want her to be.
I mean, so your zombies do whatever for money?
Yeah, pretty much. But I was setting up other than that, there's something about zombie games, and that's why you typically see a lot of them in indie development. It's because the AI for them is not a lot. And I kind of wanted to... I'm not really prepared for this, but I did want to talk about the AI behind what a zombie could be. And it usually starts off as a zombie sitting in idle, and then you want it to chase the player eventually. And then it has an attack. And other than that, there's not really a whole lot that goes into a zombie animation. There's transitions. You want it to be able to go from chase to idle. And I feel like sometimes I might like lose people during this. But you want it to be able to go from idle to chase to idle. And the same with attack. And then there's different things like once it gets done attacking, you might want it to get to like eating you on the ground. Or call eat. let's say idle, chase. We're going to say maybe while it's idling, it has a wander. So it just wanders around. And you might want it to be able to go from wander to idle, from wander to chase, or wander to attack, to eat. I mean, that's it. I mean, that's, other than maybe you want it to go from like chase, walking, running. But other than that, like, it really doesn't get much more complicated. And that's why zombie games are so popular amongst, like, indie developers. The AI is super simple. Other than the player itself, which is, you know, obviously don't have to create any AI for it because the player is controlling it. The zombie itself is usually, like, basic human instinct, and that is the easiest thing to program. But, no, it's not great. Actually, that is great, because I forgot that was there. This is actually a video. It's like beta type stuff. I'm making this game with my friend, like I said, who is starting his own... What the hell? He's starting his own game in South Carolina. That's actually where the bullet worked. See it like kind of trailing off into the distance and you shoot the zombie. And I hadn't yet set the zombie to when she died to stop the movement. So after you shot her, she would still slide towards you. They're persistent. You never want them to stop giving up, I guess. You always want to be on your toes. And it's definitely interesting just being able to get in there, even if you're not planning on making a game. Get in there and try to mess with different aspects of the engine that you plan on making it in. That's an example of her attack animation. Which the other game kind of evolved into this. It's the same character, I just named him Chris, just because I was playing a lot of Resident Evil games, but it turned into a game I was working on with some other people that was called What Remains. And I was testing different particle systems, you can see in there, different weapons. Which eventually turned into this, which I really wanted to try different art styles and like cell shading and things like that. And both of these are made in Unity. I was trying to figure out the world space UI canvases. None of these are actual games, they're just screenshots of different like tests that I was trying to run just to see what I would do. I was trying different processing effects, which are just, it's almost like if you have a camera, it's like Instagram filters almost in game engines where it's like, I want motion blur or things like that. This is obviously black and white. There's like sepia, there's, I don't even know if I'm saying that right. But there's tons of different effects that you can just put, it's actually on the camera itself and not in the game. All these trees are outside of the Unity asset store. They're all free. They're just there to play around with. This upsets me. because on my screen it doesn't look that bright, and you can't, and you can't actually see her. You can just see the area around her. But it's the first attempt at trying to make something that would be good in VR, because we were trying to think of something that would just like be an interactive experience that you would put a VR headset on and watch happen in front of you. This was the first attempt. I did a lot of the 3D modeling for it, and a lot of the animations we got off of mixamo.com. Free animations, if you have your own humanoid FBX, you can actually upload it to the site, set up rigging points, and it'll rig it for you, and then you can use any of their animations based on that rig. So it's free, it's there for you to use. I would go for it. But it was the first test, I was trying to make something scary. Kind of defeats the purpose if it looks really good and creepy to you, but then you send it to someone else and they're like, you know, we can see the entire background, right? And that's pretty much what happened. And they're like, it looks creepy, we can see her knees, but we also can see her. This I just threw in there. This is the first time I delved into Unreal Engine. Started making my grandma's house. Level design in Unreal is something else. It's super nice. All engines have their own. They have their own. I don't know what the word is. I guess pluses and minuses. Pros and cons. Yeah. There's destructibles in Unreal are super easy to make in Unity. It would probably take a little more programming and mesh design to do it. Unreal has all that stuff built in. So I was making targets. Example of blueprints in Unreal. It's a visual scripting system that they have where, this isn't a really great example. I have another one that has like a bunch of like for else loops and for else statements loops. Switches is what they call if statements. Arrays, lists, things like that. But it's really easy to understand almost. It's easier to write than actual code. Gives you, like, sometimes when I'm writing code, it just feels like I have carpal tunnel, like I'm just waiting for it to happen any minute. But this is just like click and drag, it's super nice. And this is actually all that makes this character move and follow you with the animation that it has. And, okay, well, that's the credits, I guess. All these pictures were used with Unity, Unreal, Mixamo, Maya, Blender, Photoshop, and GIMP. GIMP, free photo. How much the brightness on a screen will actually do to a game. You need a plan just up there. Let's see. This was last week we started working on a game for the expo. And we thought we'd have it done by the expo, but it actually didn't get done. But this is all done in VR. I'm recording this wearing a Vive headset. We were pretty much just trying to time these animations to events happening in front of the player. And again, these are either models or animations that I got from Mixamo, which are, if you ever pay for Adobe Creative Cloud Suite, it's like $20 a month and you get a shit ton of stuff for free. It's definitely worth it if you're creating. That particle system needs some work. Michael knows about it. controller because I'm not worried about it at all. I haven't even started worrying about what kind of controls it needs. But the concept of this game so far is that it's a Weeping Angels, and I had to Google what it meant. There's another programmer on the project, Alex Clay, and I pretty much had to figure out what it meant. But I guess it's, when you're looking at an object, it's not moving, but there's another object moving towards you at the same time. So you kind of have to keep looking at each object, hoping that each one doesn't get to you. There's a couple games with the same concept, especially in VR. That's in the middle of the screen right now, is the first sign of any life in this video. There's another one over there. Getting a little bit closer. I haven't asked him about it, but I'm pretty sure one moves faster than the other. But ask him about it, but to be honest, that the little clown that's kind of somewhere to the right, that's been used in a ton of horror games. That one I actually made myself. But other than that, I mean, that was done in a week. It's like a little VR challenge we wanted to try ourselves with.
Is that in Unreal or in Unity?
That was in Unity. Mm-hmm. And all you need to do to get started at it's not as simple as Unreal, because I feel like in Unreal, all you have to do to even make games in VR is hit Alt V when you're inside of the engine, and it just, you can even get in there and like edit inside of the editor with the controls. But in Unity, they have a Steam VR plugin, and you install that, get it running, and then that's your camera, and then it's pretty much all set up for you. A lot of these plugins are other than that, like, I've pretty much, the only thing that I've actually spent money on game development-wise is, I paid $20 for my license to publish on the Google Play Store. Yeah, I mean, and that was one time, that was just for that one game, and that was pretty much it. Other than that, I've tried to do with as much as I can, but with as many free things as I can. And it's, with this lab especially, it's definitely take advantage of a lot of the stuff. Like the SDKs, I'm pretty sure, are already set and linked to the Unity, like, Unity plugins. Yeah, I mean, I'm not really sure what else to go into other than just, like, if anyone had any questions, I feel like.
Yeah. So in that zombie game, do you make all the character models yourself?
It depends. The Chris character, the main character?
The Chris character, in the one where she was walking towards you.
I didn't make the one where she's walking towards you. The actual zombie model was made by a Japanese 3D artist, and that is on Mixamo for you to download. The only thing that they require you, once they upload a character to Mixamo, the only thing that they ask is that you credit them. So, like, if I were to use her in an actual game, it would just be me crediting the artist. The Chris character I actually made myself, and I have all the license to, so, like, I could use him in whatever game. That's why it was, like, three different games. yeah, but other than that, it just depends on what you use. Kind of.
And then, did you also do the art in the Simple Machines game?
In the what?
The game about Simple Machines.
Darren Storm.
I wish she was here, but at Strictly Business, it's a combination of the two. I made some of the assets. A lot of the things in the game are JSON objects, so when you go to click on them, pretty much anything in that game is selectable. I made a couple of them. My girlfriend Ryan Dyer, she's usually lingering in the back making stuff, but she made a lot of the artwork for that. But then there were some that we kind of got off Shutterstock, which is totally okay. If you pay for a license to use Shutterstock, a lot of that comes with a license to use that commercially. So
yes.
There's not really any shame in doing that. And that necessarily wasn't one of our choices. That was a supervisor said, let's use Shutterstock, and we used it. So that's up to them.
Actually, two more, but I'll ask one more.
Yep.
So, how long did it take to get your game on the Google Play Store, all in all?
Yeah, I was going to ask a question about that.
Not long at all. Probably too little of time. you mean to get it on there? Like, how long did it take me to get it on there, or was there a waiting period between I submitted it and it getting on there?
More the former. Like, from the game being done to you being done submitting it.
Being done. A lot of people think it's like game development is something like fashion, where it's like it's never finished. It's kind of like that. It doesn't take much of anything to get something onto the Google Play Store. I made that sitting in the desk bar back there on the left. I made that in like a couple days. I submitted to the Google Play Store. It probably took one day for them to get back with me, and they asked me what I wanted to rate it. I'd say total. It probably took 1 week to get it from like concept, like I'm gonna do this, to it's on the Google Play Store. It took me a week.
Nice.
But at the same time, it probably shouldn't be on there. It's really broken. There's not a lot of like user experience. Like right now, if you click the back button, Unity does a lot of this stuff for you too, where the back button on a phone essentially has the same programming as the escape button on a keyboard. So if you program escape inside of your Unity game, at least if you have an Android, if you hit the back button, it has the same function as the escape button. So if you do that right now in that game, if you hit that, it brings up a menu. It says, do you want to quit? But at the same time, it doesn't stop the delta time inside of the game. So the animations are still running. So while you have the menu and it's like, do you want to quit? And you're going to hit it, and it hits one of those blocks and restarts the game, it just takes you back to the beginning of the game. And that's a bind with Google Play. And it's not great. And probably doesn't reflect well on me. But I mean, it's there. And it took about a week to get on there. There's not a whole lot of screen process, other than the fact that they want you to have at least one video trailer of gameplay, at least like 15 seconds long. It's like a 512 pixel by 200 pixel like banner for the top, and then some type of icon that they ended.